3 o'clock in the morning when you have a flood which puts a town between 1 and 2 metres underwater. I mean, some of these people are still asleep.
Hello, it's ESS here.
You hear stories of people who are woken up by emergency services and, of course, they're floating in a bed.
When I come downtown, you can see just like a tidal wave coming through town.
They had a 40 horsepower motor on the back of a boat and they were still battling to make headway.
The water was over the rear vision mirrors of a Land Cruiser.
During the day of Saturday, March the 20th, tropical cyclone Elaine crossed the coast and dropped significant falls as it made its way east.
We had a automatic weather station at Dalwongnu. Late Friday, early Saturday, it decides to fail.
The town had no knowledge of the huge quantity of rain filling the river catchment.
Probably about 80 and 90 millimetres occurred within that 6 hour period over the majority of the Moora River catchment above the Moora.
The Moora River rose nearly 5 metres on the night of March 20. It swept over its banks, peaking nearly 2 metres above the town bridge.
We went into a false sense of security because we had contacted Rivers and Waters Commission and the Weather Bureau and they said, no, this place will never flood. They'd had no idea how much rain had fallen. We had no idea how much rain had fallen.
By morning, the town was still in flood, but the peak had passed. The night of quick-thinking rescues had been successful. No lives lost, no major injuries.
The rescues that we had was just astronomical when, you know, you could nominate hundreds of people in this town for bravery awards. But where do you start?
Rescues occurred in pitch blackness. Sewerage overflowed and there was live electricity.
The SES went round turning off the power. There was the chemicals, there was also the sewerage plant had broken down.
The gas cylinders was the main problem. They were breaking away from there and floating away. And chemicals in some of the stock agents would sell the chemicals around here.
In the middle of the flood, 4 o'clock in the morning, Mrs. Renzetti, we pulled up to the front of her place and the water's up to the, well, up to halfway up the doors on the Land Cruiser. Water's coming through her house and I tapped on a window and she says, there's a little bit of water in here. And I said, yeah, we've come to evacuate you. And she says, why? And walking into the house and getting all her medicine and got a rug to throw around her and that, one of the other SES guys helped me carry her out.
We walked across the main street on our ankles. We turned around to go back to our cars, probably 5 minutes later. It was up to our knees. We went to sandbag the front businesses. It was up to our hips. So we then decided, no, that's no good. You know, waste of time, the businesses were gone. Then a bus come along and he said he was going up to the lodge. He's going to need help there. You know, we had to sort of evacuate the old people's homes. And it was scary for us because we took 2 people out and the water was already up to our knees in a dry parking area. You couldn't hurry them up. You couldn't just pick them up and get them dressed. When we finally emptied out the lodge, we got to the hospital. I said, guess what? You've got to do it all again. You've got to evacuate the hospital.
During the night, hundreds of people were evacuated to the high school.
The other self-organised groups that come about in the community, people who had trucks and tractors, who just knew that this is what we've got to do. We've got to get these big vehicles out, big appliances that can do the job, that can safely carry people, you know, from one spot to another through these raging waters.
With the SES and police officers flooded, coordination and control had to operate out of the high school.
By 5:45, we managed to get key players in the community together to have our first operations coordination group meeting, and that was the opportunity then for me to actually sit with the group in a control position and say, right, these are our priorities.
Moora's LEMAC, its local emergency management advisory committee, was not fully in place.
We have been working 18 months trying to convince the council to come on board.
Ironically, the last LEMAC meeting was 3 days before the flood.
And in the end I said, you know, in a place like this, we're surrounded by bridges. Flood is a major hazard. If we had 200 millimetres of rain, this town would be wiped out. And of course it started raining on Thursday. But before it started raining, they said, yes, we will come on board. The problem was, though, is that we didn't have an actual plan to run on.
We now realise the importance of it, but there are other communities that won't realise the importance of a LEMAC committee. We think now it's vitally critical that you do have this, but we didn't prior to the flood.
Without a fully implemented LEMAC, rescues relied heavily on leadership for success.
The Shire president is an exceptional person who did a very, very good job. and one of the most important agencies in the LEMAC is the local government authority, and they needed to be across what the emergency services and others in the town were doing.
The rescues had not been without difficulties. Communication between SES and fire service volunteers and police had been impossible. Their vehicles worked on different radio frequencies and the mobile net was down.
There was no communications with anybody. The only communications we had was from vehicle to vehicle. You know, when you can't talk to anybody, it's who cares if the fire truck's 100 yards down the road? Nobody can talk to him.
The head boy from the high school realised there was a need for a go-between, someone who knew the town, who could relay messages between rescue teams. He did it on foot.
I would respond to those calls and send whatever fire units were required to those areas. I'd have to chase them down somewhere around the town and try and get them there as soon as you could.
One real point in the structure of FISA is try and get an integrated radio system. Like we work on a UHF bands and they work on a VHF bands. And now if we can try and get one band set up between us all, it would make communications a lot easier.
Excuse me, do you people need nappies, milk or anything for your babies? If you come first...
Catholic primary school principal Sally O'Day assumed an administrative role.
It was mainly information and just to help and say that, oh, what about old Mrs. So-and-so? Has anyone checked on her? And to help with, oh, that's this street or that street, because we were local people and many of the SES people, you know, wouldn't know who needed and where to go.
There were people arriving that were wet. There were people arriving that were being carried off vehicles from the hospital. There were people arriving that were in stretchers. There were people arriving that were in wheelchairs. There was a makeshift hospital being put together upstairs. It was just all happening.
The force of the water burst the catch on the Yale lock and just opened the front door, and she just went, picked up all the furniture, out through two glass doors and out the back and down to Gillinger or somewhere.
What are you going to do now?
I don't know. I don't feel like going back in the house again. But I'll have to, I suppose.
Confusion, reluctance, stunned, disbelieving. Why did it happen to me? All of those emotions.
I still get emotional now about in my role and as a principal you sort of are meant to cope, and I was telling many people that yes, you have to go and you will do that now. And that was actually very stressful and very emotional because people didn't want to go.
The evacuations to Perth began early on Sunday morning. The sick and the elderly were airlifted first.
We saw the trauma out there too of our own people, seeing little babies being handed over with mothers, newborn babies.
Beautiful. It's a feeling of emptiness, but great pride when you see people jump in and help like this, and I think it just shows the strength of the community.
To evacuate those that want to be evacuated from Moora. The place that we have arranged for you is a place called Noalimba.
More difficulties arose. Not everyone had made it to the high school. Hundreds had fled to the recreation centre on the other side of the river.
We had no idea what was over in the recreation centre until we managed to get someone over there. By midday on the Sunday, we had the 15 coaches there to take them south.
One other major threat loomed over Moora, Cyclone Vance.
With a saturated catchment, all the lakes full, river already running, we would probably have to evacuate the entire town.
At this stage, it looks as though Cyclone Vance has passed us, so we're in a stage of going from alert into recovery.
During these first days, extensive help arrived. Three floodboats, police rubber ducks, 29 SES units, approximately 500 volunteer workers assisted.
We're disposing of the commercial food waste from all the food premises in town. With the food going putrescible, we'll be getting fly problems, rodent problems and animal problems.
We let it be known to those remaining in town through the services of the fire rescue service going around the town with their loud hailer that there was a meeting to take place in the evening and followed by a free evening meal.
That proved to be extremely beneficial for the whole community because it got the whole community together. The spirit of the rural community really came through at those meetings, so very important.
Once the immediate crisis was over, the next task was deciding when to withdraw.
Once the basic life-threatening situation is over, once the rescues are over, once the bulk clean-up is done, the rotting food in fridges and so forth, it's time really to start thinking about putting in place the recovery process. It was approximately day three from memory that I decided it was time that Michael Bates, the Shire President, should lead the recovery process. And we started working towards it. You feel a sense of ownership of an operation like that. It's often hard to tear yourself away.
In that transition period from the emergency to the recovery stage, we were immediately involved in all the meetings with the SES, with FISA. It was a joint operation, and I think the amount of control that was shown by the emergency services was perfect for the situation and the way that it was handled.
The clean-up of Moora continued. Evacuees returned in three stages once electricity had been returned. Businesses and farms assessed their losses along with the residents.
Don't go into too much of a panic. Have a look, see what you like.
Go away, you go.
Eight weeks later, Moora flooded again.
Hugh, the local manager of the SES, Thursday morning, he rings me up and he says, there's some serious rain up here, it looks like it's going to flood again. I said, I don't believe this, Hugh, couldn't.
This time it was Alan Gale's turn to take the helm as flood controller.
This time we're able to actually say, there's the high risk area, the area that we're confident is going to go under. And that's either side of the Moora River, basically. And that was evacuated, people walking around knocking on doors and asking people to leave.
Hello, it's the SES!
For this flood, there was warning, and there was a much greater lead-up time before the flood, and the town knew of the impact of flooding.
Hello, it looks like you're all ready to go.
I am.
Yes, well, we're now starting to evacuate.
But there was also increased frustration and tension in town.
I can remember a situation where one of the people came racing out the door with a broom, wielding it towards our people who took off down the road.
This time, the media was used extensively to tell people when to leave and where to go.
We got a lot of things into line. We were trying to think ahead as to what we needed to be done, how many crews we'd had to have up there available in event of evacuating people. We had good communications. That was up and running very early.
But with the warning and the long wait for the floodwaters to rise, and with the previous experience so close to people's hearts, LEMAC meetings became difficult. Town and business people wanted to be involved.
At times at the LEMAC meeting, there were about 35 people, and quite a few of those were businesses in town. People have to be aware that you only need key people there, keep the meetings very brief, just updating, so that's all you need. Concerns of the general community should go to the Shire because Shire represents them.
Paid off, eh? We just had new cupboards put through 2 days ago and, yeah, out of our own money because no insurance. So, yeah, pretty bad.
Come
I put up everything on the benches, as you can see, and so I didn't lose all my chairs and everything. But we've put all new floor coverings down, repainted, done all the work, and now we've just got to start again.
The previous experience from the first flood had advantages, however, for FISA.
Well, we had the bushfire service. They came up in recovery mode, just the cleaning up side of things, to go out to different locations for pumping out under houses. They worked very well. It was just having that all the resources, it makes things run a lot smoother. You can get through the tasks a lot easier.
And I went up on the Sunday and there was definitely FISA there then. The volunteer fire and rescue service, they come up as clean-up teams, mop-up teams, recovery teams.
Instead of being a very long operation, you can cut that time down to bare minimum, and then everyone can get back to normal and into line in a minimal time.
What we've got happening, guys, is the evacuees are all due in here any minute now. It'll be two buses arriving. 75 people. Since they get here, we're going to deliver them in for lunch. Looking for any problems that SES could assist with, so use your own reconnaissance skills while you're there. One certainly treats people with compassion.
Oh, where's your muscles, eh? Didn't have your spinach this morning, huh?
For the owners of the 80 houses which went under again, it was a second depressing blow. Returning on the evacuation buses for a second time was the prelude to cleaning up the invasive mud again.
Yuck! Okay, it's very muddy out here, kids. Have you got any shoes handy or not? Everything in the fridge is all right? There's no spoils in there?
No.
Okay, what about your animals? They all right?
Probably traumatised, but yeah, no, they should be fine.
All right, yeah, so.